This morning, I'm continuing the message series called Positive Principles from Proverbs. Proverbs is not a book of stories. It's a book of wisdom. It's a book of short, pithy sayings about life. And Proverbs has wise sayings to offer about planning your life, marriage, parenting, money management, controlling your anger, speaking wisely to people, and staying humble. Proverbs reminds you that God is concerned not just about the big monumental events of life, but also about the mundane, everyday moments of life. Today we continue our journey in Proverbs by considering the topic, the war of words. Sticks and stones may break my bones, but words will never hurt me. That modern proverb that most of us learned while we were a child has to be one of the greatest lies ever told. Words can hurt, and they can hurt for a long time. Long after the broken bones have mended and the scars and bruises have healed, we carry the pain of those thoughtless and hurtful words that people speak to us. Can you remember a hurtful name that somebody called you when you were a child? Or a comment that somebody made about your appearance that just devastated your ego? Or a false rumor that somebody spread about you? Or a harsh comment from a parent or an authority figure that simply broke your heart? Several years ago, I attended a Promise Keepers event at an old stadium in Washington, D.C. It was the last event held in this stadium because the next week they tore it down. And I remember watching on television as they systematically destroyed this old stadium. A team of experts placed explosives in strategic locations and they set them off in rapid fire precision. The stadium collapsed on itself in a matter of minutes. And I was amazed that it only took a few minutes to destroy what took years to plan and to build. That illustration reminded me that words have the ability to build, and they also have the power to destroy. By the words we speak, we can either be in the construction business or the demolition business. With our words, we can build up a person over a lifetime, or in a moment, using verbal explosives, we can harm and damage people for life. Words are powerful. They can build up a person's character, or they can destroy a person's reputation. Words send a message. Words have power. Words matter. And it's for this reason that there are over 150 proverbs about how we use our words. Solomon understood the power of words, and he wants all of his readers to understand that power as well. So if you have your Bible this morning, I invite you to open it to the Old Testament book of Proverbs. This morning, we're going to look at some proverbs that talk about the war of words. And I've chosen two passages as our text today. We're going to look at Proverbs chapter 6, verses 16 through 19, and Proverbs chapter 18, verse 21. Now, these verses will be on the screen. They're also in your message notes. Proverbs chapter 6, verses 16 through 19. There are six things the Lord hates. Seven are detestable to Him. Haughty eyes, a lying tongue, hands that shed innocent blood, a heart that devises wicked schemes, feet that are quick to rush into evil, a false witness who pours out lies, and a person who stirs up conflict in the community. Then Proverbs 18:21 says, the tongue has the power of life and death, and those who love it will eat its fruit. Words can both heal and hurt. They can boost and they can burden. They can encourage and they can crush. So this morning I want to share from Proverbs three kinds of speech to avoid. And we're also going to talk about the opposite of these three things that we need to apply. So the first thing to avoid, number one, little lies. We need to avoid lying. Now it's worth noting that two of the seven things that God hates, according to Proverbs 6, 16 through 19, involve lying. A lying tongue and a false witness who pours out lies. God hates lying because it's the opposite of his nature. Hebrews 6:18 and Titus 1:2 clearly state that God does not and cannot tell a lie. God's character is truth. God cannot tell us lies. So lies don't originate with God. Lies originate with the devil. Jesus describes the devil in John 8:44 using these words. You belong to your father, the devil, and you want to carry out your father's desires. He was a murderer from the beginning, not holding to the truth, for there is no truth in him. When he lies, he speaks his native language, for he is a liar and the father of lies. The Bible makes it clear that Satan lies. In talking with Eve in the Garden of Eden, Satan questions God's command. Did God really say, you must not eat from any tree in this garden? Then Satan goes from questioning God to telling an outright lie. You will not certainly die, the serpent says to the woman. Satan lied at the beginning and he continues to lie today. When you tell a lie, you're acting like the devil. You're not acting like God. Yet, lying is so much a part of our world today that we think it's normal. I mean, we expect to lie and we expect other people to lie. We expect lying in politics, business, marriage, dating, income tax forms, job applications, advertising, and even in school. But lying comes with a cost. You greet someone with a big smile and you hug them. But the truth is you have an issue with that person. But you don't have the courage to confront him or her. You say, everything is going great in our marriage. But the truth is that the relationship can best be described as cold and icy. You say, you know, I'm not worried about finding a new job. I know that God is going to provide. But the truth is that you spent the last three nights awake, worried about your future. You say, everything's great in my relationship with God. But the truth is you can't remember the last time you said an honest prayer and felt close to God. Why do we lie? Why do we mask the truth? We don't want to look bad in the eyes of other people. We don't want people to think less of us. We want to maintain our image, so we forfeit the truth so that we can please people and protect what they think about us. But what seems like a harmless lie becomes more difficult and complicated over time. It looked like the easy way out, but now it's become rather difficult. People's trust in us decreases. Our stress level increases. Now we have to remember what version of the story we told to each person. So it's no wonder that Proverbs 12:19 says, truthful lips endure forever, but a lying tongue lasts only a moment. What's the opposite of lying? Ephesians 4:15 says, speaking the truth in love, we will in all things grow up into Him who is the head, that is Christ. The Bible tells us to speak the truth to each other in love. It's a sign of maturity to quit lying and speak truth to other people. So if we're going to break this habit of lying, well, you're going to have to be truthful about everything. You must be truthful not just in the big things, but in the everyday choices that you make. You need to ask yourself, have I lied to anyone today? Have I misled anyone? Have I stretched the truth to make myself look good in the eyes of other people? Little lies can result in big trouble. Number two, we need to avoid rotten rumors. We need to avoid gossiping about people and slandering people's character. Proverbs 6:19 says that the seventh thing that God hates is a person who stirs up trouble and conflict in the community. But today, it's almost normal that we say bad things about other people. It's become an epidemic in our culture. You hear it on the news, in the office, in the neighborhood, at school, and on social media. Accusations are shared without any evidence, without any proof, potentially shattering somebody's credibility. The new standard seems to be that if enough people whisper it, it must be true. Gossip involves secret communication. A person spreading gossip will often preface their words by saying, now, I know I'm not supposed to tell you this, but, don't quote me on this, but, don't tell anybody, but I heard. The more pious gossipers will say, now, I'm only telling you this so you can pray about it. Proverbs chapter 20, verse 19 warns, a gossip betrays a confidence, so avoid anyone who talks too much. Proverbs 11, 13 says something similar. A gossip betrays a confidence, but a trustworthy person keeps a secret. Steve Poe points out that most gossipers are like the person who says, I just want my friends to know that it's not me who's starting all of these rumors. It's the people I'm sharing them with. Have you spread some gossip this week? Do you enjoy engaging in and listening to gossip? Do you find yourself criticizing other people and belittling other people so that you can look good? If you're going to overcome this habit of gossiping, you have to learn the wisdom of silence. The book of Proverbs teaches that a wise person will often keep his thoughts to himself. Proverbs 11:12 says, whoever derides their neighbor has no sense, but the one who has understanding holds their tongue. Proverbs 13:3, those who guard their lips preserve their lives, but those who speak rashly will come to ruin. I believe Solomon would concur with humorist Will Durant, who says, nothing is often a good thing to do, and almost always a clever thing to say. Rotten rumors can ruin other people. They can ruin you, too. Number three, terrible talk. We need to avoid speaking negatively to people and start speaking positively to people. Proverbs 18:21 reminds us that the tongue has the power of life and death. Our words can breathe life into someone. They also have the power to destroy somebody's well-being. Do you have a negative tongue or a positive tongue? Think about these questions. How do you normally talk to your spouse? How do you talk to your children? How do you talk to the people you work with? How do you talk to the people that you call your friends? Are your words positive or negative? Is your tone of voice positive or negative? Are your facial expressions and your nonverbal cues positive or negative? Your words matter. How you talk to people says a lot about you, and it has a great impact on the people in your life as well. A study was done among parents. The goal was to record all the positive statements and all the negative statements that they said to their children during the course of a day. The result was that for every positive statement, parents averaged 10 negative statements. Imagine what those negative statements are doing to the heart of that child. Imagine how those negative statements are impacting that child's future. Why don't we understand the impact of negative words? Well, there's a deception involved, and that deception is this. I can get a good result through bad words. How does that work? Well, it shows up in marriage all the time. One spouse thinks, I don't like the way this marriage is going. I don't like the way my spouse is treating me. So I'm going to threaten divorce and straighten him up. I'm going to threaten divorce and wake her up. I'm going to let my spouse know that my lawyer is only a phone call away. Before divorce happens, it gets prophesied in the marriage. By speaking the word, you give Satan the opportunity to make it happen. The best way to make sure divorce never enters your life is to never say the word. Don't talk about it. Don't threaten it. Don't even consider it an option. You can't produce a good result in your spouse's behavior by using manipulation and threats. It's a deception. And it works the same way with cussing and verbal abuse. Many people think, if I hurt you bad enough, then you're going to wake up and do the right thing. So I'm going to cuss you and curse you and belittle you until you straighten up. But it never works that way. If you abuse somebody with your words, you're either going to get a mouthful right back at you, or you're going to create a person who becomes a doormat for your abuse. You're going to create a person who starts believing all those negative images that you're placing upon them. Don't be deceived. The impact of negative words is always negative. When you hurt somebody with your words, they're not going to straighten up. I mean, calling somebody stupid, an idiot, a jerk is not going to help them behave in a wonderful way. Instead, those words are going to hurt them. They're going to tear them down. They're going to demoralize them. You know, I've never met a person who said, you know, before that cussing out, I never really saw the light. But you know, those cuss words just did me so much good. Thank you. And the next time I'm out of line, just feel free to cuss me out again. No, You can't get a positive result using negative words. If you're going to break the habit of speaking negatively to people, you're going to have to start speaking positive words to people. And you're surrounded by a bunch of people who would love to be built up with encouraging words. So many people in our culture have been put down and abused with negative words all their life. You can help them. You can speak positive words to them and help them discover their gifts and their abilities. You can offer words of comfort and prayers to people who are hurting. You can encourage somebody who's feeling down. You can help people understand that there truly is a God in heaven who loves them. Words have impact. Positive words have positive impact. Proverbs 25:11 says, "A word aptly spoken is like apples of gold in settings of silver." Who in your life right now needs to hear a positive word from you? Who is God placing on your heart right now? Think about it. How would you like to be known in your marriage, in your family, in your place of business, in your school, in your church? Would you like to be known as a person who puts down people? Or would you like to be known as a person who builds up people? When it comes to the war of words, are you in the construction business or the demolition business? The answer to that question depends upon how you speak to people. Terrible talk will only give you terrible results. But encouraging talk can give you encouraging results. Think about the positive future that you can speak into the life of your child. Think about the words that you can use to build a close relationship in your marriage. Think about the positive environment that you can help create right here at First Baptist Church by speaking positive words to people. When it comes to the war of words, don't get into the demolition business. Get into the construction business. Your words can make a huge difference in the lives of people. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for these proverbs. And we just touched a few of them. There's about 150 of them that talk about how we use our words. Because how we use our words is really important. Father, we live in a culture that's in the demolition business. We hear it every day. We turn on the television, it's obvious. We hear people talk on the radio, it's obvious. We look at social media, it's obvious. People are tearing people apart with their words. And Father, I think everybody in this room today has had at least one person in their life say something negative and bad about them. And we know that it hurts. Father, I pray that all of us will leave here today with a vision of speaking positive words into the people that they love. Father, we say we love all these people. Let us show it by how we talk to them and how we talk with them. Father, may we be people who are always building people up. May we say words of encouragement and words that will help people understand how much they're loved by you. And Father, on the video we watched today, we just saw a complete change of atmosphere when the words went from negative to positive. Father, may we be the people who speak positive words. May that be something that we practice every single day. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen.